Good morning and welcome to Church Together. We are so glad that you're here tuning in to worship with us this morning. We know many of you may be on our new app, you may be on our website, still tuning in with us on Facebook. And if you are doing that, we do encourage the conversation. We hope you can use the comment box and speak with each other this morning. We just know that during this time when there are struggles going on, it is just so important for us to come together and worship our God. And we're just so grateful that we can still do this together. We're hoping that in a couple of weeks on August 16th, we will be able to welcome some people back into the worship space with us and be able to be together. But as we're monitoring that, we just are wanting to focus on the fact that no matter what, we're able to come and honor and glorify our God and praise Him together through all the things that we do this morning. So I just ask that you all go to your kitchens now, because this morning we're going to be able to have communion together. Pastor Andy's going to lead us in that. So if you have a chance now to get bread and juice and be able to partake together, I wanted to tell you about that in the beginning. But at this time, if we can now open our service in prayer, Pastor Andy.
Thanks, Jen. That's the great thing about watching on the app. You can take your service with you into the kitchen while you get some bread and juice for communion. Friends, it's good to see you. Let's begin this time of worship together in prayer. Lord, I thank you that we can be connected to each other and we can be connected to you even though we're apart. I thank you that your presence is with us. Your spirit is in our homes. And so I pray, Lord, that over these next few minutes, you would help us to do what we were created to do and to worship you. Lord, we pause for a moment and we remember your goodness in our lives this week. And we say thank you. So during this time, open our hearts and help us to worship. And we ask and we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning, church. So glad you're with us today. Just wanted to take a moment before we worship to actually talk about worship. This is what Andy's going to talk about a little bit later. But we tend to use that word for singing, but it's actually much more than singing. So I just wanted to share a quote by Archbishop William Temple. To worship is to quicken the conscience by the holiness of God, to feed the mind with the truth of God, to purge the imagination by the beauty of God, to open the heart to the love of God, and to devote the will to the purpose of God. So as we sing, we recognize that's just one part of worshiping. Let's think about all of those different ways we love and worship our God. Amen? Let's sing together. where we normally do the echoes, church. So we can try it. I'll sing it, you echo at home. Church, with our emphasis on worship this morning, we're actually going to go back to what we used to do and do three songs in a row for our worship set. So let's sing For the Cause.
For the cause of Christ the King, we give our lives an offering till all the earth resounds and sees this praise. For the cause of Christ we go, with joy to reap, with faith to sow, as many see and many put their trust in the Son.
Let's sing.
Christ we proclaim, the name above. Salvation through the Son. For the King, once lifted high to cries of rage and crucified, endured the cross as every sin was laid on the Son. Conquer death to free the poor and the oppressed, for lasting peace, for life and liberty in the Son.
Let's sing the chorus. Here we go.
In Christ we proclaim the name above every name, for all creation, every nation. Salvation through the Son. We worship you, refrain to live is Christ, to die is gain, deny myself, take up my cross and follow the Son.
Let's proclaim in church. Here we go.
In Christ we proclaim the name above every name, for all creation, every nation, salvation through the Son.
Great job, church. As we continue to worship, church, we're going to lean into Psalm 36. This is Your Love, O Lord.
Your love, O Lord, it reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky. Your righteousness is like the mighty mountains, and your justice flows like the ocean's tide. And I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my in the shadow of your wings, and your love, O Lord, it reaches to the heavens. Your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky. It's like the mighty mountains. Oh, and your justice flows like the ocean's tide.
Let's lift our voice, church.
And I will lift my voice to worship you. Shadow of your wings, and I will lift my voice to worship you, my King. And I will find my strength in the shadow of your wings, your to the heavens. Your faithfulness, it stretches to the sky.
Lord, we just thank you for that truth today. We thank you that for your love for us. And Lord, we just express that and reflect that back to you in your holiness and your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
How nice of it is it to worship, guys? Now, church family, would you join me in prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we know that there is so much going on, not only in our own lives, but in this country, Lord, in the hearts of man. And we just pray so much for your intercession, that we can be filled with the Holy Spirit and we can move in action, move in grace, move in compassion towards one another. I just pray that as we're going through this time, we're trying to figure out what the next steps are, whether it's school, work, finances, that we keep the foundation of all of our decisions based in you, that we understand that even though we are anxious and fearful or just afraid, that we can find a moment of peace and joy. And that in those moments in worshiping you, Lord, that we find clarity. Lord, I just pray for the words that we're about to hear and that you work through Pastor Andy as he comes here and just speaks your truth, Lord. And I pray for the people who are listening on the other side that they have the open hearts to receive it, to internalize it, and walk away with something and walk away being closer to you. I lift all of this in your name. And our whole church said, amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ademir. Mike, thanks for leading us in worship and helping us to touch heaven. Because touching heaven and worshiping God is what I want to talk about today. Over the last few weeks, we have been talking about checking some of the warning lights in our heart, in our engine. Because we know that in difficult times, some of the levels of our faith can start to be depleted and start to cause problems for us. We've looked at our hope level and our trust level and several other levels. Today, I want to talk about our worship level. And so if you have your Bible with you, turn to Psalm 103. There's a Bible on your app. Open one on your computer. If you want to go old school like me, do that. But turn to Psalm 103 because we're going to talk today about why we need to make sure, especially in difficult times, that we continue to worship God. A few months ago, I was in a meeting with professional athletes, and we had a guest speaker, and he was talking about how good teams were physically strong. And he said, nowadays, we can measure how physically strong you are. He said, we also know that really good teams, that they have a good emotional mindset and a good emotional balance, and we're learning how to measure that. And then he went on to say that the most elite teams play with heart, but the problem with the heart is that we can't measure the heart. The heart can only be expressed. And so as I ask the question today, how's your heart? The best metric of that is how well you are expressing your love for God, expressing what is in your heart in worship. And so Psalm 103 is all about worshiping God. This past Thursday, our internet broke at home. We lost Wi-Fi. And in these pandemic times, losing Wi-Fi pretty quickly hits crisis level. The kids couldn't do their thing and watch their thing and play their thing. I couldn't do the work, get done what I needed to do. And so just a couple of minutes after it goes down, I'm on the phone to our Wi-Fi provider. They encouraged me to go to their website for support, but of course I couldn't do that because the Wi-Fi was down. And so I waited on hold for about 20, 25 minutes, and they had some soothing music. But every 30 seconds or so, they would interrupt this music with these statements about their company and these statements about how good their company was. You made a good decision when you chose us because we're the best in the business. We know that in these difficult times, you need reliability, and we're your reliable internet provider. And for 20 minutes, every 30 seconds, this music was punctuated by these words that told me how great our Wi-Fi was, all the while I'm sitting there in frustration saying, no, you're not, because when I need you the most, you've abandoned me. And it struck me. Many of us view our worship of God the same way. It's easy to agree with those statements about how great God is when things are going well. But when things are tough, and we're facing bad weather systems, and we're living in a pandemic, And we're part of an economy that's crashing and a society that's broken because of racial issues. It's real easy to say, God, I don't want to worship you right now because I'm not sure all those things are true. The end of the story was that I finally got through the representative. I told her what was going on. She told me the solution real quickly, and it turned out that the problem was my problem, not their problem. They fixed it. They were actually true to their promises. They did come through, and I was reminded that my Wi-Fi company is good even in bad times. And in the same way, as we worship God, we are acknowledging that God is good, that God is great, that God is worthy of our praise and worship, even when things are tough. So friend, I want to tell you today, even though life is far from normal, rather than quit worshiping, be intentional about worshiping more. God has not changed. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. What's changed is the stuff around us. And God presides over that stuff, so let's consistently keep worshiping Him. He deserves it, and honestly, we need to offer it. I think the psalm provides reasons why we need to worship. Psalm 103. Follow along with me so you can see that this is God's words and not mine, that there's a weight behind this that is thousands of years old, that has stood the test of time because it's the Word of God that has the authority of our great God behind it. David says, my soul, my heart, the innermost part of me, bless the Lord. What he's saying here is, I want to worship. And interestingly, as we dig into the history of this psalm, he's wanting to worship even though he's in a tough place. He says, with all that is within me, let it bless his holy name. He's saying, everything I am, God, I want to give to everything I know about you, all of me to all of you. In fact, this psalm has that word all in it 9 times. David's saying there's no half-hearted worship. We need to be all in our worship of God, no matter how we're feeling, no matter what's going on. God is still worthy of our worship. All that is within me, bless your holy name. My soul, bless the Lord. My mind, do not forget all of God's benefits. You know, last week we talked about how important it was to remember what God had done, to remember how God is with us, to remember hope. David's calling himself to that standard. I must remember the benefits of God. And to help him do that, he lists it. Listen to these benefits that he lists starting at verse 3. He forgives all our iniquity. That's why I'm going to worship. He heals all your diseases. That's why I'm going to worship. He redeems your life from the pit. That's why I'm going to worship. He crowns you with faithful love and compassion. That's why I'm going to worship. He satisfies you with all good things. Your youth is renewed like the eagle. The first thing that I believe David is saying here, as one of the primary reasons we must keep worshiping, even in difficult places and difficult times, because when we worship, we are lifted towards God. As we raise our hands, we get closer to God. Worship lifts us. Hear what he says. He forgives That's the reason for worship. You know why? Because our sin is a cancer that's destroying us. Our iniquity has separated us from God, and it's going to send us permanently away from God unless we do something about it. And the thing that needs to be done about it comes from Him, and it's forgiveness. Forgiveness goes first because it's so important. Once that obstacle has been removed, then we can worship. God forgives. When we're forgiven, we're lifted. He heals all of our diseases. I want to remind you today that one of the reasons we worship, that God is our healer. He's not obligated to heal. There are times when He doesn't heal on our timeline or our understanding. But the promise is Scripture for those who are in Christ is that ultimately we will be healed. That's a reason to worship. He redeems your life from the pit. He saves you. During this pandemic, Tracy has got into the TV show Lost. You know, we tend to be about 10 years behind on our shows. And honestly, I'm trying to watch this show Lost with her, and I haven't seen all the episodes. And I look at it, and I get lost real easily. But we were watching last night, and there was this one episode where there was this maybe 400 or 500 feet pit. And there was a nuclear bomb at the bottom of this pit and something in there that sucked all the metal objects on the island into it. And there was this one lady who was actually my favorite character in the show who got sucked into this pit 500 feet under the ground next to a nuclear device. And I thought, oh, even more reason not to watch this. My favorite character's died now. They've killed her off in the show. And so I went about my business, came back 10 minutes later, and there's that lady in the show again. Somehow she'd survived being at the bottom of a 500-foot pit with tons of steel and metal on top of her next to a nuclear bomb. I said, what happened? And Tracy said, well, you know, it's TV. All kinds of things can happen. But in my mind, as I'm preparing for that, I'm saying, hey, God redeemed her from the pit. Our sin, our brokenness has left us in a position much worse than being at the bottom of a 500-foot pit next to a nuclear bomb with tons of steel under us. And God has rescued us from that. We are redeemed. It's a reason we worship. He crowns us with faithful love and compassion. He satisfies us with all good things. Friend, when these things happen, when we remember these things, when we realize all that Jesus has done for us, then we are lifted. Worship lifts us. It lifts us from the pit. It lifts us out of our despair. It lifts us into a new reality. David ends this little section by saying, He satisfies you with good things, verse 5. Your youth is renewed like the eagle. I don't know if you knew this about the eagles, but when eagles get old and their wings and their feathers get tired so that they can't fly again, their old wings kind of fall off and new wings grow back. So old birds can have new wings so that they can fly again. That's the story of the gospel. Broken, messed up sinners get new wings and we can fly again, and we must keep worshiping because worship lifts us. It lifts you out of your sin. It lifts you out of your despair. It lifts you out of your shame. And so even in tough times, we worship because worship lifts us. Don't stop worshiping because we all need a lift right now. The psalmist continues, verse 6. The Lord executes acts of righteousness and justice for all the oppressed. Have you ever tried even just for a few minutes to do everything right, perfectly right? Try it. You won't be able to do it. It's impossible. We cannot be right on our own. We cannot be just on our own. Yet God is executing acts of righteousness and justice. And when he does, and when we see it, it humbles us. The Lord is compassionate and gracious. He's slow to anger and abounding in faithful love. Think about that. God is compassionate towards us. We've experienced that. He's gracious. We see that. He's slow to anger when we deserve it. He's abounding in his faithful love even when we're unfaithful. That humbles us, right? He will not always accuse us or be angry forever. He has not dealt with us as our sins deserve. You know what we call that? We call that grace. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus, a pardon received, that's called grace. And it humbles us. He's repaid us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love. He's talking about God's power, his omnipresence, the scope of his love. And when we see the size of God, we're humbled by it. In this first section, if David was saying, when we worship, we're lifted, what he's saying in this second section is that when we worship, we're lowered. We're humbled. When we see acts of righteousness and justice, it humbles us. When we see that God is compassionate and gracious and gives us what we don't deserve, it humbles us. When we see the scope and size and power of God and who we are, it humbles us. Worship lifts us, and that's appropriate, but worship also must humble us. I don't know if you've read any of the Chronicles of Narnia books, but there's this great little paragraph in the Prince Caspian book. When Lucy meets Aslan, the Christ Messiah figure, and she hasn't seen him for a while, and she says, Aslan, you've changed, you've grown, you're bigger. And Aslan, the lion, tenderly says, no, it's not me who's changed. It's just that every year you grow, you will find me bigger. What he's saying here is kind of like the image. Imagine you're walking to a mountain, right? And when you're a long way away, the mountain seems pretty small. But as you grow towards the mountain all of a sudden seems huge. And you become smaller. That's what the psalmist is saying here when he's talking about the scope and the size and the power and the grace of God. It should humble us. It should lower us. It should break us of our pride. It should cause us to pray the prayer of John the Baptist, that we must decrease so that he can increase in our life. Why must we keep worshiping? Because worship lifts us. And secondly, because worship lowers us. It makes life not about us, but about him. As we realize our smallness, we can see God's greatness. And so we must keep worshiping, because worship lifts us and worship lowers us. And then the psalmist wraps up with, I believe, one other thing that worship does. Worship lifts us, worship lowers us. And thirdly, worship allows us to be leveraged by God. Verse 20, bless the Lord, all his angels of great strength, you who do his word, obedient to his command, we follow him. Bless the Lord, all his armies, all his servants who do his will. When we worship, the king. We're putting ourselves as servants who have a purpose to be available, to be leveraged, to be used by God. Friends, I know the storms are coming. This pandemic is spreading. This injustice is still a part of our reality. As finances are tight and emotions are all over the place, it's hard to worship. Don't stop worshiping. That doesn't mean don't stop singing, but keep singing. It means keep surrendering your all to Jesus, to live your life as an act of worship. The last verse in this psalm, bless the Lord, all his works, in all the places where he rules. My soul, bless the Lord. He ends by talking about how great God's works are. You know what the greatest work is that God has done? Wrapped up in Jesus. His greatest work was that he spared his only son to come and walk among us, to teach us a way to worship in our lives, to teach us a way to worship in our relationship, to teach us a way to worship in our soul. But we didn't want to hear it. So we sent him to the cross where he died. But we know the rest of the story. 3 days later, he did this amazing work that is worthy of all of our worship. And he rose from the dead. And he said, it is finished. God's greatest work was Jesus. And so today, as we've talked about worship, we point to Jesus, the visible image of the invisible God, and we look at his life and his love and his death and his resurrection and all that he's taught and all that he's said and all that he's done and all that it's won. And it causes us to worship. Worship lifts us. Worship lowers us. Worship leverages us to be used by God. Let's pray together. Lord, this week, even though times are tough, even though worry is high, and uncertainty is the only thing that we can be certain of, would you help us to worship? Would you help us to express our hearts in worship? And as we do, may our worship lift us from our pits and into your presence. And as we do, may our worship of you destroy our pride and lower us to a humble position where we realize and we see clearly that you are the king and we are the servant. And then, Lord, as we worship, would you take our lives and use them as an act of living worship for your name and for your sake and for your glory. Amen. The beginning of our service, Jen encouraged you to grab a piece of bread and some juice, some liquid, because I'm going to invite you to remember and worship Jesus with us as we share together this act of Holy Communion. I'm going to invite Adam here to join us. And in communion, we remember that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took some bread and he broke it And he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Every time you eat of it, remember me." On that same night, he took a cup of wine. And he held it aloft and he blessed it. And he said, "This is the blood of the new covenant that is poured out for you." Jesus was preparing to give his life as an act of worship. As you in your home, in your yard, on your patio, wherever you are, partaking communion, use this time to remember all that Jesus has done and won. And to once again, surrender your life to God in worship. Adam, this is the body of Christ that is broken for you. Take, eat, and drink. Friends, this is the body and blood of Christ broken and poured out for you. Eat, drink, and rejoice. Let's pray together. We thank you, Lord, that you have fed us in this sacrament, that you have united us with Christ and given us a foretaste of the holy banquet prepared for you and all mankind. Lord, as we remember that you laid down your life as a sacrificial act of worship, help us to offer our lives in worship as well. And we ask and we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I meet with you and my soul sings out, as your word throws doubt far away. I sing to you and my heart cries holy, hallelujah, Father, you're near. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm, and the peace that passes understanding is my song, and I sing, my hope is in you, Lord. I wait for you, and my soul finds rest. In my selfishness, you show me grace. Thank you, Lord. Worship you, and my heart cries glory, hallelujah, Father, you're here. My hope is in you, Lord, all the day long. I won't be shaken by drought or storm, and the peace that passes understanding is my song. Sing, my hope is in you, Lord. I will wait on you. You are my refuge. Let's believe that, church. I will wait on you. You are my refuge. Day long, I won't
Amen. Amen. That's our hope, church. Let's leave singing today.
Thank you, Mike, for leading us in worship today and reminding us of where our hope is. Friends, we're coming to the end of this service, but certainly not coming to the end of the opportunity to worship this week. And we pray you take every opportunity you can. Few things that we'd like to share with you. Join us online throughout the week. We have Moments of Hope on Thursday, our prayer meeting on Wednesday. Make sure you download our app and visit our new website. There's lots of ways that you can engage and connect right there. I would like to personally invite you to join me and leaders from other churches and our community tonight, either online or in person at Divine Truth Christian Fellowship, as we host the first of three conversations among our community on race and reconciliation. Today, we're talking about our racist history. And the goal of this is to help us all understand some of the problems we're facing and where they come from. So if you can't join us in person, there's a very limited number because of social distancing. Please join us on the Facebook page, Community Conversations on Race and Reconciliation, and we'll also post the talk on our webpage as soon as we have that feed. That's 6 o'clock tonight. Going to invite Jen to come and share an announcement with us too.
Yes, I want to encourage all the children to come onto Zoom in just a few minutes, actually. At 11:15, we're going to have Zoom Children's Church. And I wanted to tell all of the church family that we're starting a new unit called Jesus as the God of Healing. So last week, we actually were able to do the first story of the centurion's servant being healed. And this week, we're going to talk about the paralytic man being healed. And each of these stories is allowing us to be able to talk about how Jesus's authority and power and compassion can heal, but also how all these internal, eternal impacts come from the things that Jesus does in these miracles. And so I'm excited to talk to the kids about it some more. At 11:15 this morning, go to your email, get on the Zoom link, and come see us come together as we worship as a children's ministry.
All right, friends, thanks for joining us in worship. Would you receive this benediction as you worship Him this week? As you worship in a way that lifts you and lowers you and leverages you, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you. And may the Lord lift up His countenance to you. We ask and we pray in Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, my friends. We'll see you real soon. Bye-bye.